Okay, welcome to the, what are we on? October.
October.
October. We went through
Happy
September
Halloween.
So fast. Oh, man, this is the October version
of the October edition
the Bedford Common.
Of Bedford Common.
And I'm Ralph, and you are?
I'm still Julie.
You're still Julie. We haven't changed at all.
No.
We ought to switch. I'll switch our seats
we
and
could.
Keep
and
our
then,
names.
And
that'll
nobody will know.
No, we'll be cool.
But that'll be all right.
But we have fantastic guests this time. This
we
is
always
the,
have fantastic guests.
But we
guests.
Have new fantastic
this
guests.
This is true. Well, we've had Sean. Sean has been
okay.
here before.
Well, which one's Sean?
This is Sean, right here. Okay,
Gone
so we
the
have
dead,
Sean Hannigan representing the planning board. Yay, Sean. We have Bill Moonen, who is chair of the selectmen. We have Paul Mortensen here for the finance committee tonight. And Daniel Broskel, chair of the school committee.
The school committee.
Daniel, yes, here I am.
Daniel,
there you go.
Right here.
So does anybody have exciting news?
Oh, come on, not for the town of Bedford. We've been going like crazy.
So
I get a fill in. With Sean sitting right here, I attended the planning board meeting last Tuesday night.
You did?
It was a hearing. They had four hearings that night. Usually when you see the word hearing, you say, oh, man, we don't want to be there, because they were hearings of the special wording within the bylaws and all that stuff. This was a hearing on real good things that are happening in Bedford. Sean, tell a little bit. That was the most fantastic meeting I'd ever been to.
Whoa! I'm sorry for this one.
It was.
Well, that's a lesson learned. You never want to miss a planning board hearing.
I'll be there the next one.
Okay, sounds good. So yes, as Ralph referred to, we have a lot of development going on. It's been very busy. After being a little slow for a while, it seems like the floodgates have opened. So those hearings that you refer to are all development cases, and of course I don't want to list them all because I know we only have a limited amount of time,
right.
But let me hit on some of the key points. The Pine Hill Crossing, that is the former Coast Guard housing, is actually reaching now the end of its multi-year expedition through the different town boards and town meetings. So if you remember back in the spring, town meeting approved a rezoning to enable that project to happen, and now we're at the special permit phase. So we had an initial special permit hearing. There'll be another one October 2nd, which probably is
a little late for
a little late for
yeah.
this, but if you're interested, there probably will be further ones after that to have one final say into the hearing and how.
Well, so are they looking at new buildings now, infill stuff?
It's a little bit of different design, a little bit.
That's exactly it, yeah. Ralph. So the amount of buildings have already been set. So it's 29 total buildings there, which is a mix between existing buildings and then adding the new buildings. But it's the design that's different, that's unique from even the in town meeting, they came up with a conceptual design that we kept trying to stress was conceptual. We weren't voting on the design because it could change. And it turned out that they looked at it and they figured out a way that to myself and to most of the board members seems a little bit better because it's more clustered, so it retains more houses around a common area closer to the parking so that people don't have to walk a long way, more accessible. I mean, of course, there are some things that we still need to work out, but that was really the big change between the conceptual
right.
model in town meeting and the current one.
And the open community space in the middle was really nice.
I think that will really be good.
Yeah.
That will really be good amenity to that new neighborhood that's being developed there.
Tell a bit about the Crosby Drive one. That was another fascinating one.
Yeah, so that's an
that
interesting
one. Is that the
one
that's come back a couple times? No, never mind.
No, across the street.
I'm wrong. You're
they
wrong.
Have talked to us preliminarily a couple times, but this is somewhere between 40 and 60 Crosby Drive, so there's actually a couple parcels. If you're familiar with the area, it's where Oracle sits right now.
Yeah.
And they're talking about redeveloping, so instead of having one building, there'll be three buildings. Now there's a sea of parking, but the intention is to have structured parking and then open up some of that sea of parking for green space, walking. In fact, there's been some thought to how to improve access to public transit in the area, potentially a nice walkway. The Shawshing River isn't that far from there. It'd be nice to have a nice walkway that connects all of those properties with the river access. That's something that was actually somewhat preliminary, so we'll see them again, but that's what's going on in that particular area. Page Place is looking at, if you remember, a couple town meetings ago, they came with the idea of looking to build a garage for some of the people that are in the condos there, and then to offset the cost of the garage by building a new structure and new units in that. At that town meeting, they opted to go through a change in the bylaw. There is a specific zone that governs that area because it's a former school. Now they are looking at a different approach where they're looking at amending the original special permit and actually creating the new building under underlying zoning. So it gets a bit complicated, but it is interesting. It's something that is visible to a lot of people if you drive by that area around Route 62. And they'll be coming back again. They'll actually be back on October 2nd. And another thing is the Davis Road boardwalk. So
yes,
that has gone through.
Out,
in fact,
right?
I think, Ralph, you might have been on the Transportation Committee when that started to come up.
I was, as a matter of fact.
It was percolating. And,
and then all of a sudden, it just took right off.
It took right off, and I credit the neighbors, the people in that neighborhood with really pushing that, because it's unconventional. If you're familiar with that part of Davis Road,
you just can't walk.
You can't walk because it's a road and then like marsh and
just goes down.
So the intention is to put a boardwalk. So you can't put a sidewalk, but the boardwalk would serve the purposes of connectivity with that area of town with the other sidewalk network.
But it opens up walking to downtown.
The White Cedar Swamp.
Yep.
Have you started talking about when it would begin, when the construction would begin?
That's, I don't know that, but okay. I do know that it's in kind of, so what we had to do in planning board is look at it because it was involved removing some trees in a scenic road. And we're one of the final hurdles. So that means that the regulatory process should be done soon and construction can hopefully begin relatively soon. But there hasn't been a set date as to that.
Okay.
So that would be
but
up to the DPW.
Forward.
It is moving forward.
But soon means like within a year, hopefully. Yeah, that's
fabulous.
Cool.
Yeah. One thing, I don't want to take up too much time, but town meeting, just to go over it quickly, we're going to have some cleanup items. So you won't be seeing a lot of excitement from the planning board, but that's okay because I think we gave you a lot of excitement the last few town meetings.
So. I think your excitement quotient has evaporated.
That's right. We'll let the other people in town
meeting. Bill has a lot.
Yeah.
Bill, are you bringing excitement to town meeting, the selectmen? You played basketball in high school, I hear.
No, actually, I didn't. I did not.
I'm sorry.
But we are getting ready for the special town meeting, but it's just a matter of getting the warrant together. There is one article by petition that will be on the town meeting. It's a request from from people who are concerned about solar panels.
Yeah.
And they would like the town to automatically approve solar panels on the roof of any building in the historic district if it meets certain conditions. There is questions about whether such a bylaw meets state requirements, because most of the rules that control the historic district are written by the legislature and not bylaws of the town. But I'm not a lawyer, and I'm not going to...
And we haven't gotten there yet.
Right, we haven't gotten there yet. One of the things that the selectmen did do recently is we approved what's called remote participation. And now it would be possible for people who cannot get to a meeting, provided they have all of the documentation that the members of the committee have, that they will be able to participate in the meeting. They cannot count as a quorum, so there has to be a quorum actually attending the meeting. And it is audio only. It's not television. It's not Skype or something like that yet. And it can't be for trivial reasons like, I don't want to come tonight.
Snowing.
But if you're out of town, you
got to be out of town or laid up in a hospital or something.
So that's to attend the meeting.
That would be to attend and vote and be part of the meeting if you're a committee member.
Right. But most important, keep in mind though, a lot of these committees, like the planning board and the selectmen, they're all on YouTube, so you can tune right in, or they're on the regular regular nights on the channel. I'm not sure what the schedule is when they pop up. I haven't figured that out yet.
It's when the tape gets uploaded. You have to editing, and then it gets posted.
But anyway, watch the, it's commercial-free TV when you watch it. I watched the school committee one the other
community
night. I was really impressed with that.
Community media. Yeah. So, and you also have a big excitement on Monday, October 1st.
Yes, we have a brand new town manager.
Oh, she
she's coming.
This will be her first meeting?
Sarah Stanton will be joining us at the selectman's meeting, and we're having a swearing, my mouth has had that party all by itself. We're having a swearing-in ceremony for her
at
8 o'clock on Monday morning, and then she will be thrown into the deep end of the pool, and we'll see how she swims.
At her first town.
Well, that'll be a long day for 8 o'clock in the morning until a selectman's meeting.
We've been dealing with the infrastructure in town. We the selectman approved a design contract for two sewer pump stations that need refurbishing, staying on top of that on a regular basis. We approved a conservation restriction that was granted to the Sudbury Valley trustees for about 36 acres of land that's located on Concord Road. We bought this land, the town did many years ago, to prevent a 40B construction. Some of it.
Your Princeton property thing? It was a part of the Princeton property?
Yes.
Ah, great.
It is the lowlands with a little bit of upland buffer.
It's a gorgeous area, right?
It will
protect along the bike path.
Yep. We established new rates for second trash carts and overflow bags. The cost of collecting trash has gone up 30%. We have not raised the rates on either of those items for since 2011, so it's been at least 7 years. And they currently, for those of you who might be interested in getting a second cart or in getting some more trash bags, they are now going to be $132 for the second cart, up from $100. And the bags, which you can get at local stores, you don't buy from the town. And by the way, the stores don't make any profit on them. We'll be going to $9.75 a roll, which is a 5-bag roll, I think, up from $7.50, both of which reflect less than the 30% increase in cost.
So, quick question. If you have two carts out on a regular basis, is your rubbish assessment the same as someone who has one cart, or do you get?
All of your rubbish collection is paid through your tax.
Okay, so there's
there's no individual charge. The charge for the second barrel
is
to get
pay
it
for the barrel.
And,
okay.
And have it in your possession.
All right, fair enough.
And of course, the more you recycle, the less you have to put out for trash.
And stay tuned, because Ed McGrath is going to come and talk to us just about recycling after the break.
We got to give a special shout out, since we're into some of the DPW stuff. Busy summer doing all the construction, and and they cleaned out the water pipes on Hemlock Lane.
Yep.
Brand new clean water. I couldn't believe it to see what they scraped out of those things. But yeah, it's the town has been right on top of maintaining our property in good shape. Thanks to the selectman's guidance.
Speaking of maintaining property, we're also in the process of continuing to look at alternatives to deal with the fire station, no longer serves the needs of the fire department. There's every alternative on the table, from building a brand new station at some other location, tearing down the existing one, building a new station there, rehabbing the existing station, and maybe building an auxiliary station out Crosby Drive area.
Yeah.
Everything's being looked at, and something's going to have to be done soon.
Yeah, like the planning board meeting, that selectman's meeting, especially when you're talking about the fire station, unbelievably great meeting. And the town, if you weren't at the meeting, watch it on YouTube.
There you are.
Yeah.
And money. Is there money coming out of?
Well, so right now, not much excitement in finance.
This is officially Paul's.
So oh, yes.
He's our new person
there
here.
There you go.
At home, it's Mr. Secretary, since I'm the Secretary of the Finance Committee.
Okay,
not all the time do I insist upon that. But truly, not much going on in the Finance Committee. We've, last few Thursdays, we've taken off, and we're waiting for the warrant for the next special town meeting, so we're
to see whether you have to balance out accounts and things.
Yes, yeah, so that always happens, but it always works out fine. So I'm here to report not much.
So
that sounds like good news.
Yes, I believe so.
Clue me into the queue, though. So you'll be taking the numbers from this new, from the special town meeting.
Right.
Do they come out of the current tax base, or do they come out of for next year? How does it work?
Wow.
Sorry.
I think they come out of the current year.
Okay, so that's where it's worked from. Okay.
Right.
Oh, yeah, actually, it's just, as he said, it's just a matter of balancing numbers. Sometimes what we vote in March doesn't always match exactly what gets spent when everything's done, and so we have to move a few bucks around.
Right.
So that's when you sharpen the pencils and make all the good
exactly.
stuff happen.
Exactly. Really, it's our town accountant, Victor, who does most of the sharpening. He couldn't be better.
Victor
so.
Is super. Yeah. I'm impressed with Victor. Good. Is there, what's going on? Anything happening at school here or anything?
It started.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Did the kids all get in?
As far as I know. Well, we kept a bear away from Davis. That was pretty important. It was roaming the neighborhoods.
Oh,
and
that
was
right.
probably.
How do you do recess duty when you have a bear walking around?
There actually was one on Donovan Drive up behind Lane School.
And one up on Old Causeway last night. So it's
exactly
The bear thing is a bear thing is a thing. I don't know. It's weird.
It's when you're doing recess duty, you watch for those.
When you're running too. So Bedford Day was great, but that was wonderful. Happy birthday, Bikeway. That's also exciting.
Oh, yes.
So
preface
my comments with that. But school is open. I think we've had a great start. There's really good spirit in the buildings. The new Lane Playground, which I hinted at in September, is awesome. And I think kids are having a pretty good time, and the buses are running, and I think people are happy. Back to school nights are some good early season business for the schools. The Lane ones are all done. Davis's are on the 27th and October 2nd. JGMS is next Thursday, and BHS is on the 11th. So go to back to school night to see everything that's exciting.
And those are just for parents.
Just for parents, but you know, the older your kids get, the less you hear, as most of us know. Mm-hmm. So it's good to go and actually hear what's actually happening from the teachers, and they're all great. Speaking to BHS, there's two openings on the parent council, so parents should vote when you have the opportunity in your email to look at the candidates, both for the Hanscom representative and for the Boston representative. That voting closes soon, so please get that in.
And that's high school representative.
BHS parent council, yes.
The other schools have all their
I think they're fully filled. But yeah, the biggest news item of the committee is the building projects, which are ongoing. And we voted to approve two major projects. One is a renovation and expansion at JGMS, and one is a renovation only at BHS. And if you read the Citizens article, you saw the details, which I'll recap really quickly. At JGMS, two additions at the northeast and southeast corner. That's the Plateau Field and towards the parking lot there by I-Field. That's 7,500 square feet. There's interior renovation at 3,600 square feet, and that's going to be a sale room, an OT room, an art room, two foreign language rooms, a health room, teacher workspace, counselor offices, and spaces for Bridge and SPED. At BHS, only renovation, mostly in D block, which is a block that faces the library parking lot. A new sale classroom, a new learning center, a new ELL space, new counselor space, new life skills space, METCO and SRO offices, a new space for junior ROTC, and we're going to move CASE and the preschool to Davis for next September. So for 2019 and 2020, that preschool and CASE will be out, and that space will be worked on during the school year. Some really exciting news. On Monday, the Commonwealth's Education Commissioner is coming to Bedford to visit the Lane School because we're awesome, and also to see Megan Hannafin teaching reading. We sent her to Columbia this summer, Columbia University, to do a special workshop, and he's going to come and check out how great that is. That's my daughter's teacher, and I get to go.
And we'll see you there.
So I think we'll have some other elected officials there as well, which is exciting. Also going on, new for this year, really thanks to Anne Gui, is that the district is looking at a program called Challenge Success, which is about how districts can make kids less stressed and feeling safer from a health perspective in schools. And I always say, like, we're not trying to make school harder. We're trying to make it a better place for kids. Mm-hmm. And this is exactly like that. So Heather and Kate Sussman, who's a ceramics teacher, and a couple of students went out to Stanford for the weekend a couple weeks ago and had a whole weekend of training and learning and meeting other districts that were doing it. And we're thrilled to see how that looks like, you know, in Bedford. And that's cool. They left on Thursday night and they came back on the red eye on Monday, and we're in school on Monday morning.
Wow. Can I add on that?
Cool. Absolutely.
So my wife was one of the parents who joined. And Thursday morning, 4 a.m. Yep. wake up call to drive them in. And then Monday morning, I believe I was at Logan at 1:30 in the morning driving them back.
Fabulous. So thank you for doing that.
No charge to the town. It was my pleasure.
Thank you for doing that.
Yeah.
So your empirical estimation of the trip was?
My wife thought it was fantastic. Yeah. She took lots of notes, and she's, you know, getting together with the principal, and you know, they'll be talking about it more. But some really interesting ideas, you know, running the gamut from should we start school later, and you know, all sorts of neato things that is very impressive.
Yeah, I love it.
Kids report stress, even in Bedford, right?
Mm-hmm.
But luckily less compared to some neighboring districts, so we want to take care of that.
And very early kids are talking about stress.
Oh, yeah. Well, and this is a part of the culture, which is unfortunate, so we'd like to push back a little bit on that. And kids have outlets like sports, and just some early season sports highlights. I think last month I said the boys' soccer team looked good. They are. They're 4-1-1. They played on Tuesday in the rain, and they beat Weston.
All right.
And they play Boston Latin at Concord on Saturday, which is winnable. Cross-country runner Jasper Shapiro, who's really, really fast. He ran a 16:42 on the trails over 5K, which is really fast. And the volleyball team did improve to 500 yesterday, thanks to Cam Rackey and Kate Winkler playing really well. So sports are good. Football team is winless, but they play Friday at home again. So maybe this will change the tide.
Well, they've already played.
They played three games.
I thought when you said they were winless, maybe they had.
No, they are losses. They're lossful and winless. But maybe the first one against Newburyport this Friday at 7. So maybe we'll see you there.
At Bedford Day, I got to chat with the people from the Performing Arts Department.
Yeah.
What a phenomenal program we have in not only the performing arts, but the visual arts. And the you know, the music, unbelievable.
Bedford Day was a revelation. I've been to many, and many of us have. That was awesome.
And it was.
The kids and the performances bands and the weather. Like it was like peak Bedford and no bears. Peak Bedford Day.
Yeah. And the floats. A shout out to Troop 194.
Yeah.
Did you see Troop 194?
No.
Float?
What did they do?
Well, it started out with a pickup truck with a cab on the cover on the back. And on top of that was a canoe, a full-size Old Town canoe, with two scout leaders
paddling away.
Then there was a trailer with a campsite on it, a bunch of
kids. Oh, really? In a tent?
Then at the very end, there was a small trailer that was, what, maybe three or four feet square? Yeah. And it had a lawn chair on it.
That's pretty good.
And there was a scout leader there sitting quite relaxed, but sitting there and fishing.
Oh, yeah, his fishing pole.
Had his fishing pole, and there was a red wagon following this third element with the fishing.
It was like a train.
It was like a train. Gee, it was absolutely fabulous. Shout out to the constructors.
So the parade was really a fin.
The parade was fit. There were three bicycle floats.
Oh, really? Oh, that's right. And Tucker was in one of them.
And Tucker was in one of them, and the world came along. It was absolutely fabulous. Absolutely fabulous.
Bedford is a fabulous town. Thanks to all the hardworking people like yourselves.
There
really,
you go.
This is super. Thank you all very much.
Did we miss anything?
Yeah, let's make it. Did we cover all the points?
I think so.
Yes. Come to come to town meeting in a month.
November 13th, Tuesday the 13th.
That'll be. Yeah.
And don't forget to vote.
Oh, that's right. That's coming right up too. Yes.
November, is it the 4th?
I think it's the 4th,
I'm really embarrassed. But there is an important national election coming up the first Tuesday in November.
That's right.
And it would behoove all of us to be there. No matter what you want to vote for, please come and vote, because if everybody votes, everybody has a say, and then nobody can argue about it. We can argue about it. But
can't complain.
Bedford has a good turnout anyway.
Exactly. Yeah. We want everybody there, please. Okay. So what else did we forget?
Looks like we got it all.
Fabulous. Well,
thank you all very much for coming in.
Amen. And for you at home, if you'll stay tuned, please, we'll be talking about recycling and service dogs. It's very good, I think.
And if you missed the planning board meeting or the selectmen's meeting or the school committee meeting, tune in and watch it on TV. They're really good.
There you go. And so are the finance committee meetings, but those will come on later on.
Do they? Yeah, we haven't quite got don't quite want to do it. They're still sharpening their pencils. Boy. Yeah.
Well, writing really good minutes.
And one of the things that is true, there is a lot of detail in a finance committee meeting, and sometimes it is kind of like watching paint dry. And so they are maybe wise in saying we would
not do it.
Right, and there's a lot of unchewed food in your meetings.
You're too generous saying the paint dry. It's worse than that.
I think there's a lot of stuff that isn't final that gets chatted up.
I think that's true. And I think some of the folks are say, you know, we're not elected officials. They're a little bit too shy to really want to be on TV and think it might change the tone of the meetings. But
we'll see. Never can tell.
But never can tell.
The Finance Committee has really kept their eyes on the finances of our town, and they've done a great job for years and years and years. And we don't want to change it one bit.
Amen.
And the other thing that the Finance Committee does before town meeting, the wonderful things that you put out that talk about each article and the
we've just started that, and it's we like doing that. And it's some work, but we like doing it.
We like reading it. Anyway, enough of this stuff.
Thank you very much for tuning
Come
in.
Come to town meeting.
Yes.
Watch the meetings on television, and we'll see you next month. It will be November then.
That's right.
No, we'll see you in a few minutes.
Yeah,
we'll
stay
right
tuned
back
for Ed McGrath.
That's right.
And I'm Debbie Malone and Operation Delta Dogs.
That's right. Good. Take that part out.
No, we put it in.
No, my blather about it.
Okay, thank you all very much.
Beautiful.
Welcome back to Bedford Common. I'm Ralph Hammond. This is my partner in crime, Julie Turner.
Still Julie Turner.
And our special guest is
Ed McGrath. What does Ed do?
I don't know. He recycles something or other. Maybe me. No, I'm not.
No,
ready.
You're no.
Not
I don't.
Ready
for, they I, won't don't accept I don't.
Me.
I don't see that.
They won't accept.
Are
me
you a container?
I know.
Are you a plastic bag?
That's fine. He's the expert. What you been recycling lately, Ed?
trying to recycle a lot of stuff.
you know,
the, we get what we're going to be doing October 20th is going to be the fall recycling event. So we'll be doing recycling on that day.
Okay.
At 9 to 12 at the DPW down on Great Road.
That's October 20th.
October
20th. On Saturday morning.
Right. Yep. And we're going to, once again, we'll have paper shredding on site. We're going to do electronic waste this time.
Oh. Can I bring printers?
Yep. Printers.
Oh, great.
You know, think of office machines. They'll take any type of cell phone, stereo equipment. Pretty much anything with a board, you know. They say anything with a cord, but they're looking for that has like electronic boards in it. That's what they're going to be looking
and
for.
And so then do they take the apart?
Yeah,
and
they'll demanufacture it and pull off all the metals and whatever. So,
okay.
But, you know, I've had people ask about it, and so we were able to, the reason it's October 20th was the first Saturday this fall he was available. So, and that was last spring. So I booked it right away. And,
good man.
We're good to go. We're going to be collecting scrap metal from residents again.
I was just paddling up the Shawshene River. I found a tire in there. Can I bring that down?
Yes, that's the other thing. We're going to do tires again. Yep. We're doing propane tanks again. Those, if you've got the valve broken, and fire extinguishers, and we're going to do rigid plastics. I'm not sure if those will get recycled, but given the current state of affairs in the recycling world, but they're bulky. It'll give people a chance to get rid of a bulk item that they can't fit in their trash cart. And then we'll be doing the, you know, as usual, fluorescent lamps and the different types of rechargeable batteries, sealed lead acid batteries. I always get some guy coming in who's just so happy to move this. It's been in his garage for 2 years.
And a car battery?
Not just a charger battery, some type of battery. He's like, you take these, you know, and so
fabulous.
We take that. So we're going to be doing that.
How about styrofoam? That's always been a problem.
Styrofoam, we used to collect it.
Yes.
And then the company we used went out of business.
Oh, man.
And the companies, one company I looked at, there's a couple companies, it's just so expensive and the weight is so negligible. One company wants me to collect it in 55-gallon clear plastic bags, only wants the packing material, nothing to do with food, and when I get a trailer load of bags, they'll come pick it up for $500.
Oh, gee.
And I don't have the place to store it. I don't,
or the, you know, $500.
Yeah, so it's just, I'd rather be focusing on heavier stuff that's going to, you know, yeah, the value. The big thing now in recycling is make sure the items of value, cardboard, metal, aluminum, you know, get into the recycling stream, because that's the big push right now. I was at a meeting a couple weeks ago, and that's the big push. So I'm focusing on trying to get these type of materials.
So what would be a recyclable aluminum?
Like an aluminum, some people, aluminum can, your trays,
the food tray.
We just did this, you know, you buy these big trays.
You got to clean them up though.
Yeah, you got to clean the food, out of it. But, you know, those type of trays, aluminum foil, I roll mine up in a ball so it gets through the...
aluminum foil goes in there. Yeah. So you just make a snowball
Make a snowball, exactly.
And just wash it first.
Just make sure there's no food on it. Rinse it off, yeah. The reason for the food is, and I don't want to gross people out, but I was told that when they inspect these containers that have been closed,
they
open it up, and if it reeks, they close it and reject it. So that's why
we're
pushing. Basically, the industry's saying, you know, empty and rinse and empty. So if you have a half a bottle of Gatorade, pour the Gatorade out and then recycle the bottle, because that Gatorade becomes a contaminant. It gets, bottle breaks. The fluids get all over, the paper sticks to the metal, sticks to everything, and it's just a mess.
Well, and it's also false weight.
Yes.
Yeah. So back to the regular recycling.
Yep.
So you still can recycle containers like...
cottage cheese.
Yeah.
Cottage cheese and those plastic ones. But I just learned when we were chatting before this began about the orange juice containers.
Yeah.
At the last show, you said, orange juice, I used to throw them all away.
Yeah, so what happened was... In May, I sent out a mailing announcing that we're not taking the plastic bags, and the milk cartons have been on our list for a couple years now. 3 weeks later, I went to another meeting, and we were told what the state did was they met with 6 of the 7 recycling facilities, and they came up with a master list. So every town in Mass has got the same list.
Yeah.
And they got rid of the cartons because they aren't a large part of the stream. The facility's got to sort them out, bale them, and then hold them until they get a trailer load, and they're getting shipped off to Wisconsin to be recycled. And sometimes, especially in the summer, the milk cartons tend to...
Milk,
orange juice, lemonade, the Newman's lemonade, all those type. They call them gable top cartons.
Top things,
so that type of thing. I mean, we talked about the milk cartons and the milks in the schools. You know, the issue is those are too small.
Yeah.
They don't even make it through the sorting process. They fall out and they wind up as trash.
Well, we've heard that some of the people who are working with composting and trying to get the Black Earth people to come and pick up compost in Bedford are also working with the schools to try and see if they can get the...
salad-like stuff?
No, get the undrunk milk and water out of the rubbish from the... Do you think that'll ever happen?
Well, we did a trial with it at the Lane School a year or so ago. And the two lunch periods, we did 50 pounds of liquid came out. We weighed the pails. So, yeah, I'd like to get that out. You know, there's a lot of dots to connect. And we're working on it. We're working on, you know, the DPW is working on doing something regarding food waste at the schools, the town center. Yeah. And I added the fire station because I'm sure, you know, my experience with fire stations is a kitchen, and they're cooking a lot. So if we can get, we're looking at town buildings right now, and then roll it, wade into the pool, then roll it out, you know, let residents subscribe.
Would there ever be a way to bring that kind of a compost bin to the compost area out on Carlisle Road?
We're not set up, not right now, because when you add food waste to that, management.
You bring in all the mice and rats.
What I've seen in other towns that do it, Needham does that, they take commercial, but they're waiting for the load to come in, and they have the site prepared for it, dumps, and they get it all stirred up so the critters don't, you know.
All right.
So there's a lot of effort, it just doesn't happen, you know. There's resources that need to be there and stuff like that.
Well, I guess I would report to you that among my Facebook friends, there is a great deal of enthusiasm for door-to-door pickup.
Yep. Really?
Of
compost?
Of food waste.
Potential
compost.
Not the meat.
Tomorrow's compost.
I got to share my little prop.
Oh, yeah, you've got a prop.
Which camera are we on? Are we on this camera here? Just changed the battery in my car, not the big one, but the one for my keys. And I said, well, this is nothing. I'll just throw it in the wastebasket, and who cares? But I said, maybe I better talk to Ed first. So I brought it in, and this one has a CR on it. Does that mean it's, what do I do with it?
Well, we collect them down at the DPW. I'll collect them on October 20th, and there's a couple containers. I think there's one at the town center in the COA, and there's one around the town clerk's desk there in the lobby of town hall. We take them and we get them recycled. The issue is some of these batteries have lithium in them, some have mercury, so some have alkaline. So we're not asking residents to make that determination. Just give them to us. And
well, then you send them off.
I send them off.
You have a good second life.
They wind
for
up
them.
At lab. We send them to recycle the batteries plus bulbs and Woburn with all our other batteries, and he turns them over to lab, and they sort them out and get the heavy metal ones out. And
so the kids are doing it. Then they can graph the results and everything else. That is cool.
So it's an easy one to do.
So even though it seems like easy to throw away, nobody will notice.
Yeah. The only ones you could.
If
ones
it has
you
lithium
throw,
in it, though, mercury, you're doing it.
The only batteries that should go in the trash are alkaline.
And those are the flashlight
batteries.
They
say alkaline on them. 90% of them say alkaline right on the label. They can go in the trash. If they don't say alkaline, they'll say something like zero mercury, zero lead, zero cadmium. Those are basically alkaline batteries.
But they're recyclable.
Yeah, like power tools, the NiCads. Yeah. There's some small AA size batteries, nickel metal hydride. There's lithium batteries,
those
all kinds
big
of
ones on your telephone.
Yep, or your laptops or whatever. We take all those down at the DPW all through the year.
Great.
Right in the front lobby, there's a kiosk right there. You just drop them off. And I bring them the batteries.
Plus neon lights are down.
Last year I did over 1,300 pounds of batteries out of the DPW.
Thank you, Bedford. That is very well recycled.
This is good. And make sure you show up for our Recycle Day on October 20th.
From 9 to, it's only the morning, so you'll have traffic.
Be there at 9.
People waiting out.
I've had people show up. Don't show up too early because we're not ready for you. But you end up sitting in your car and we have to, moving. Basically what I want people to know is you come in, 5 miles an hour, no backing up. Get what you want done. You're off property in less than 10 minutes, and you drive away with a smile on your face.
We got there a little bit late there last time, and boom, the line kept going the whole time. It was really good.
We just keep it moving. That's why we don't do the backing up. Just what do you got? We make it work. And I've had 250 cars. 1 year I had over 400. So in the course of 3 hours. So.
And how does it happen that the day that you pick for this is always rainy?
Well, it's going to be a rainy day.
It has been several times.
So plan on that rainy Saturday morning on October 20th.
Show up at the DPW. It is what it is.
And you don't have competition with soccer games then.
Yeah, I just pick a day. I try to avoid the garden club in the spring, and
that's
the one. And Mother's Day in May. Mother's Day and the garden club plant sale. I try to stay away from those.
Those are the two good dates.
Those
are good days avoid.
Ed McGrath, we always love it when you come in.
Well, thank you for having me. I appreciate coming.
Thank you very much, and we'll see you on October 20th at the DPW with your paper shredding, electronic waste, scrap metal, rigid plastic, propane tanks, tires, fluorescent lamps, mercury thermometers, and fire extinguishers.
In the car tire I get out of the Shawshing River.
That's right.
I think you are a hero for taking that out of the Shawshing River and putting it in your canoe.
Yes.
Oh,
okay.
Stinky.
Okay, thank you.
We'll be back in a little bit. Don't go away.
Welcome back to Bedford Common. I'm Ralph. This is Julie. And our special guests are...
You're going to talk about that because they're going to talk about dogs.
Oh, yes, they're going to talk about I know more. Before
you know
the
more
dog
than
part,
I do.
I know about the Debbie Malone part. Because
she's president of the Rotary.
Yes, she's president of the Rotary Club.
And
I'm in the Rotary Club,
things,
too. That's how I know her.
Okay, this is all good.
But with Debbie Malone, she has her special friend who is Charlotte...
Trodden.
Sorry, Charlotte. I forget it.
and they are part of something called Delta Dog.
No, Operation Delta
Dog. Operation Delta
Dog.
Yeah,
we got to get it right. And they'll explain why it's such a special organization.
And why is it called Operation Delta Dog?
So, Delta Dog is a kind of a common name for a service dog. We are with the military. We serve veterans, so we called it Operation Delta Dog.
Fabulous. Oh. And when you say you're with the military,
so yeah,
these
we're
dogs.
Not literally, I mean, we're not affiliated with the military, but we serve veterans who served in the military.
And the dogs are, when I'm through with my dog, I recycle it with you. How
not quite. So Operation Delta Dog started because our founder realized kind of almost at the same time that there were two major problems that we were facing. The first was that we had an astounding number of shelter dogs, many who were in kill shelters, that did not have a home. We also are facing a problem in
so
which...
So they were kill shelters?
Many
a
of,
lot of...
Yes.
Yeah.
Gonna be a,
yeah.
Be,
so a, yeah. literally, if they're not adopted within a certain amount of time, they're euthanized.
Oh, yeah, it's not a good scene.
It's not. No, and there's hundreds of thousands of these dogs across our country that are in shelters. We also have a problem with veterans coming back from their service, facing PTSD, traumatic brain injuries, and our veterans right now are taking their own lives, about one veteran per hour.
Oh, man.
That's,
which
yes.
is a lot, and that's about 8,000 veterans a year. So we want to try to solve two problems at once, and we rescue dogs from shelters, and we put them through an intensive training to become service dogs for veterans that have PTSD or traumatic brain injury. And we give these dogs to the veterans at no cost. A service dog is valued at about $20,000, which is what our cost is to get that dog up and running to be with the veteran. But we never want any financial issues to be a barrier for a veteran to save their life and to get the service dog that they need. So we do the entire thing with our fabulous donors and grants and special events that help us.
And how long does it take to sort of socialize a dog that has been in a shelter?
Great question. So the dogs come to us. Typically, we'll take a dog that's about a year and a half old is kind of the perfect age for us to start training a dog. And they stay in our facility for 4 months of intensive training. We have a facility in Hollis, New Hampshire, and the dogs stay there and they are trained through morning, noon, and night. Trainers are in and out working on training. The facility has a mock living room to train them. We also have little mock shopping carts and, you know, handicap doors so they can learn to open and stay near doors and do all of the real life situations that
they might be called out.
They went on a field trip yesterday down to Boston and they learned how to ride the subway and maneuver busy streets. They took
sorry we weren't there.
That would have been fun on the streets.
Wow.
They took two dogs with them for that. Those were dogs that were kind of at their end of the initial 4 months training that were
getting ready,
you know, they were getting ready to go into the real world. So after those 4 months, we then pair that dog with their veteran. And it's like anything else. You have to work with personalities and the family that that dog is going into and make sure it's a good fit. And after that, it is continues to be an intensive training with the veteran. They will work. The veteran comes into our facility 2 to 3 times per week for almost a year.
And before the dog goes home?
No, the dog will be home with them.
But they have to come back.
We call it the team. The team will come back, and they work on teaching the veteran how to work with the dog, how to continue reinforcing the behaviors that they want the dog and need the dog to help them with. And then after that, we do continue to work with the veterans, their families, and the dog through the entire life of the dog.
But the most important part is the veteran is, in a way, rescuing the dog, too, assisting
it's
in the rescuing process.
And yeah.
Dogs are being rescued.
It's so true.
Works both ways, yes.
And, you know, we had, and it's not just the veteran, their families, too, are being serviced by this. We had a little girl who came in to us about a month ago, and her family, her dad got a dog, and she donated all of her birthday presents. She said instead of birthday presents, she told her friends to bring dog food and biscuits and toys for the dog. So she brought us this truckload of stuff. And I said, I was like, oh my God, that is amazing, because I have 3 kids and I don't know that they would be giving up their presents. And she said, well, you guys gave us the dog, and now my dad comes out with us, and he goes places with us, and wow, yeah. So I have my dad.
It's a turnabout is fair.
Absolutely.
Play.
So.
But it's a lot of people getting into it. Now I can remember when you're in Rotary, before you become president, you kind of get involved with activities, and Debbie got involved and says, gee, I like this Delta dog thing. and really started working, and now this is your major theme for the year. What are some of the things that Bedford Rotary is doing in relation to the Delta dogs for your presidential year?
We have some great events coming up. We just did a program, it was a in-meeting service program about 2 days ago, where we all got together at 6 o'clock at night, and we assembled bags of everything you could think of, dog treats, gas cards. Gas cards are really important for the vets because they're back and forth to the training center so many times a week for an extended period of time.
I remember seeing a ton of dog bowls there.
We gave them dog bowls and dog toys and frisbees and, personal items for the veteran and whatever we could think of. And what's most important is it was also contributed from the community. So the community really came, they had different places, different people and organizations that were collecting these items. So we didn't really know what was coming.
Oh, they were collected in their store or their company.
We had bags and people coming in with stuff as we're trying to set up to assemble these bags. And then we brought them up to the Hollis location. They also have a location in Chelmsford. They're based out of Chelmsford, so they're Mass and New Hampshire right now. And
they filled around.
How many bags were there? Anybody ever count?
I think we ended up with about 50 bags.
That's for 50 soldiers? 50.
Yes. So our thought was
they'll be good for a while.
It'll be a nice gift. Here, meet your dog. You're a good match. And here's a goodie bag to get you started.
That's fabulous.
And all of a sudden, some of them drive a long way to get to the training sessions.
They certainly do. So right now, we have about a 40-mile radius. In which we will accept veterans because we have to make it amenable to them.
Is that a radius to Chelmsford or Hollis, New Hampshire?
So Hollis and Chelmsford are very close to each other. So from that facility.
That's fabulous. Well, if it were nothing other than the time that the veteran comes and spends with all of you in doing the training. I mean, that they have the dog afterward is just kind of a bonus to me because the personal piece, the connection piece that you all put together up front is just really amazing.
It really is.
It's important. And our trainer works so closely with them and their families. She kind of becomes part of their family, too.
Yeah.
She's a great resource for them.
At Debbie's installation as our club president last June, we had a representative that, in fact, was a Delta dog recipient.
We actually had... Who was it? Vincent.
Vincent, yes.
With his dog, and he was amazing. He was just paired with his dog a year before.
Oh, he was brand new.
He stood up in front of, he stood up in front of the all of us, people he had never met before, and he just told us about all the amazing things that he is able to do now that he wasn't able to do a year ago, and it really was a pull out of the deep, dark depression that he was in prior to
that. Yeah, it was a very professional talk he gave. It was an inspiration to all of us. I said at the very end, Debbie let me sneak in the last question. I said, could have you done this without your dog? He says, absolutely not. But then somebody else asked a cool question. What does your dog do when he's not out guiding you around or opening the door or doing the things around the house? And remember his answer to that?
He's a normal dog.
Yeah, that's what he said. He acts like a regular dog.
They know when they're working and when they're off.
There you go.
So you have maybe a couple more activities coming up, maybe a fundraiser?
We have a fundraiser coming up. We're very excited. Waxies has opened the doors for us. They have offered us a donation of 10% of all sales that whole day.
Oh, great.
So whether they come for lunch or whatever.
For lunch or brunch or dinner or appetizers.
Is that what they have?
A flyer. It's October 23rd.
Fabulous.
And we're going to have some raffle prizes. Representatives from Operation Delta Dogs are going to be there as well. We're hoping the vets will come from Hanscom because it's right outside of the base.
Yeah.
All of the proceeds that we get from that is going to come to our grant. We have put in a request for a grant, so it's going to...
Oh, a Rotary grant.
A Rotary grant, uh-huh. Right. So we're going to collect those funds, and it's going to be matched with the foundation funds from the grant, and then we're going to take that whole big check. And we have one other club that's doing it with us. It's the Littleton Club.
Ah, great.
And so we're contributing, the Bedford Rotary Club, the Rotary Club of Littleton. A few other clubs have expressed an interest in participating as well as donating. And then whatever that big check is after the grant and all these donations, we're going to be presenting that to Operation Delta Dog, hopefully in time for their big fundraiser.
Oh, it'll be on the 10th of November?
Which is the 10th of November.
I can't wait for that. I'm waiting for that one.
Is this the Walk and Wag?
This is called Walk and Wag.
Exactly.
I love the name.
This is very exciting.
Tell me about Walk and Wag, please.
Yeah. So it's our biggest fundraiser. Of the year, and it is in Carlisle, Mass, at the Great Brooks State Farm.
And it's a beautiful place to walk. A lot of people go. It's a gorgeous trail to walk through.
So it's a 2-mile walk. You can come with or without your dog. We are going to have food trucks. We are going to have frisbee catching dogs. Mm. We are going to have vendors. We have lots of stuff for sale. We are going to have a ton of activities for kids. We're going to have professional face painters and balloon makers and other surprises that I can't unveil right now. But it will be there.
That's what I'm going to go and see.
It's a wonderful event.
We're going to have major prizes for the top kid that raises the most money.
Yeah.
And the top adult.
So it's like is it like a readathon kind of thing? I'm going to walk so many miles and you give me so much.
Exactly. Yeah. Okay. So we are asking everybody to go to walkandwagforveterans.com to sign up. And once you sign up, you get a link that you can put on Facebook, you can send to your friends, you can email and say, please donate whatever you can for me to go walk 2 miles.
And come have fun with me with the food trucks
and the face painting.
So that will be under Walk and Wag or under Operation Delta Dog?
You can find it in both. So you can go to operationdeltadog.org and there's a link on it, or you can go directly to walkandwagforveterans.com and it will be there.
Okay, and we'll try to put that information up on
that'd be great.
The, on
there you
the screen.
Go. And we'll send it to the Bedford Citizen.
Yes. Yeah, Bedford Citizen too. Yeah. We'll give a commercial here.
That's yeah, there you go.
But
there
most importantly, Operation Delta Dogs is a 501c3 operation, so any contributions are tax deductible. Mm-hmm. And you can, if you don't go directly to them, work through the Bedford Rotary Club with Debbie Malone.
Yes. Another 501c3.
That is another 501c3 too. And we'll be sure that your contribution goes exactly to the veteran of choice.
And can I also just put in one other plug is we're trying to get as many Rotarians to the Walk and Rag as possible. We have several clubs in the circumference of the Carlisle Park that are coming, Westford and Concord and
so this is going to be big.
So we're trying to really get Rotarians to come.
But also non-Rotarians. I mean, they're nice people, too.
And non-Rotarians.
Like Julie. She's
and
nice.
And kids and dogs.
Yeah, it's a wonderful event.
It's going to be a fun day.
Yeah, it really is a
fabulous.
Fun day.
Fabulous. And it begins at what time?
10 a.m.
What time does the walk step off at 10?
So it's not like a 5K where there's,
you say go.
So basically you come in. Sometime in the morning, register, and then we'll send you on your little loop.
Okay. And
when you come back, there will be food.
Fabulous.
And more excitement.
And November is going to be a beautiful day.
Right. So we got October 23rd. That's the Waxies event.
Yes.
And we have November 10th.
You got it. For Walk and Wag.
Day before Veterans Day, right?
Oh, that's a long weekend.
Yes.
So you have Waxies, Walk and Wag.
Very illiterate.
Oh, I get it now.
Anyway, it is a fabulous event, it's going to be a fabulous event, and it's an outstanding program.
Thank you very much.
Absolutely outstanding. And really thank the two of you very, very much for coming.
Thank you.
Amen.
This will be good.
All right. So, the next time we see you, it will be November.
Well, that's right.
November.
Oh man, it's
Thanksgiving.
Still hot.
Well, not by November. It's not going to be that warm.
I know. Let's hope we get a
November
cooler.
November and holidays and all that jazz. But at any rate, thank you for joining us, Bedford. Now we have to wait.
Yes, and thank you very much. And thanks to our special team who's waving from the control room. Bedford TV does it great.
We do. Thank you for joining us. We will see you next month for our November edition.
Oh, man.
But in the meantime, happy Halloween.
That's right.